Now, since the Senate has rejected him, somewhat rejected him in that capacity, what happens to the role he's playing there as the acting chairman of the EFCC? Is that still legal?
You see, under a presidential system of government, the presidency has so much enormous executive powers that he can ask somebody to act for a year or two even before a confirmation. And you remembered in the United States of America during the regime of George Bush, he recommended a particular man, I think Bolton, as United Nations representative, and the Senate rejected. But he used his executive powers to almost keep him there for 2 years. But that is not the problem here. What worries me, and let me be honest about it, DSS have done their job. I have no doubt about that. That, you know, what they did was in consonance with their rights. Because if they give a situation report today, events might happen tomorrow, and it is their duty to update any report they have given. So you can't blame them. Maybe the incidents that warranted this new report on Magu was based on recent events. Okay, so you can't blame them. You can't blame the Senate, but you must blame the executive.
Why do you say so?
I believe that this revelation by this DSS must not have been unknown to the executive. They must have known about it. There is no way DSS will just send directly a report to the Senate. No way. That's what you call a coordinating agency, the National Intelligence Committee, or whatever you call it. So DSS cannot have a direct, you know, approach to the Senate. So this thing passed through a conduit part, pipe created by the executive. At that stage, when they got this negative report about Magu, why did they forward it to the Senate? At that stage, why did they not hold on, call a meeting and says, look, and call Magu himself, we are going to withdraw your name?
Because they also have the office of the NSA.
Oh, yes. You have the office of the NSA. All these reports are with them. We cannot allow this report to go to the Senate because it affects our image. We cannot recommend you, and at the same time, we now damage your reputation.
Indeed, Mr. Clarke, the other side of it is something that you lawyers might want to take up later on, because you go like, hey, he's been handling all these cases of corruption, taking people, arresting people, yet he's there in an illegal, in quote, illegal capacity because he has these things against him. In other words, he's tainted all the cases he has handled. Wouldn't that be something that a lawyer might take a hold on and want to go to?
No. Let us be honest. Except a lawyer wants to make cheap money, and cheap money is not available nowadays. Because Magu will not call any lawyer now to challenge the Senate. So a lawyer cannot wake up without a client and says he's going to court. And no, you know, I don't think a situation like that will happen. As I said, what worries me, why should the government, after the DSS report has been submitted to it, and they still forwarded it to the Senate?
That's where I wanted us to really look more into, because now we just also realize that the office of the NSA, which also oversees the DSS, one wonders why he didn't get this report. And as you highlighted, there's every possibility of they saying, hey, come on, this is a bad thing for the executive. So, Mr. President, this is what we found out. And Mr. Magu, could you please explain A, B, and Z, and possibly get a new name if it's not going to fly? But it flew and it got into the Senate and now is within the public. So does this, you know, mean, if we're trying to bring a bit of politics into this, because there's no way we can bring politics into this, if this is what we are getting already, does it in any way mean that all is not well around the presidency?
It is clear to everybody that all is not well within the presidency on this subject of appointment of the head of EFCC, because you don't need a third party to know this. They had flown the flag themselves, let's be honest. A former head of the commission, maybe 2, 3, 4, 5 years ago, made a statement in the press about Magu. And it was a very negative report she made. So the press is aware that there's a controversy surrounding Magu as a person. The public also is aware from all these reports that there's a controversy surrounding him. So it's not new news to hear that there is a negative report submitted, because we are aware that there are some schisms within the presidency. The question is, why did they not kill it? At the stage DSS wrote this report, why did the executive not kill the issue there? Call him.
Is there also a possibility, sorry to cut you, that the presidency could just well would want to use this to sound a note of warning that, look, irrespective of who else is involved in anything in our fight against corruption, we will nail the person? Because if you look at the time frame with which this is happening, 11 months ago, perhaps maybe the presidency finally got wind of what exactly is in that report, and they were reluctant in withdrawing or moving ahead with that nomination, confirmation, because this is not the first time Mr. Magu had come before the Senate. And when he did come this time around, everyone would have thought it was going to be a take a bow and go scenario, but we got the shocker on that day.
I will not buy the story that a shocker. Magu himself, being a policeman and with the experience, must have known about this report. He himself must have known that there's a negative report, you know, in the Senate awaiting him. So nothing like a shocker to any another. Let's be honest. He's a policeman. If he does not know, then he's not a good policeman. Now, my problem is this. Government is fighting corruption. Government is pushing its number one man to fight this corruption, knowing fully well that, you know, there is a comma against his name. What sort of fight is that? What impression are they giving to people? I am not aware, let me be honest, I am not holding brief for the president. I am not holding brief because it's not everything that goes around the presidency, you know, even though the bubble or whatever they say stops at his table. But I'm not holding brief for him, because if he had known, I don't think he would have allowed the name again to be resubmitted. They would have withdrawn the name. But I think the problem is that the kitchen cabinet of the presidency has to be looked into. The fault is within the kitchen cabinet. They must have been divided into two, the pro and the cons of Magu. And now they are giving a bad image to the presidency. They are even giving a bad image against the fight against corruption. Because the same government that has been so very active in fighting corruption is the same person who is bringing somebody whom you are now saying is tainted in corruption. It's a blow on the face of the presidency. But I am sure the president is not aware of the situation. The problem is with the kitchen cabinet of Mr. President.
Okay.
Well, if we're to go with the headlines that we've seen today, with the Senate saying we have not rejected Mr. Magu, we've only sent things back to the executive, which you say should be blamed. How do you see things panning out from here? Because now we hear that the president has ordered an investigation into the matter. Do you see him being represented to the Senate? And if he is, with the initial security report that they had, how do you think matters will proceed?
Well, as I said initially, it's a question of half a dozen and six. The Senate says we have not rejected it because they met in the committee of the Senate. Because the committee of the Senate is forced to look into the recommendation. If it approves it, it allows it to go to the plenary. But as I said, this committee of the Senate is made up of the whole members of the Senate. Is the plenary now going into a committee? So there's no difference between it and the plenary. So, if they say they reject it, I believe it's the Senate that has rejected it. So, if they say they have not rejected it and they are sending it back, it means we cannot approve it. Let's forget the word, the semantic word rejected. We are not rejecting it, but we cannot approve it. So, take it back and, you know, do whatever you want to do with it. It amounts to rejection, whichever language, the way you want to paint it. If I send a paper to you for approval, and you say, I'm not rejecting your paper, but I'm not going to approve it, I'll send it back to you. What does that mean? It's just, the same thing. So they have rejected it, let's be honest about it, since they have not given it an approval. Now, Mr. President says he's going to look into it. Is it with the means of, for the purpose of looking at the purpose of the rejection, or to accept the rejection because of the report, and then send in another name? I don't see what was to be investigated. The Senate has given a reason why they have rejected it, or they have refused to approve it, whichever way you want to look at it. Is the government going to return the same man with such a negative report and say, okay, we have looked into it, we have investigated, the report is wrong. The report is fabricated. We are still returning him. No way. Government will stick to that report if they want to maintain a credibility. A report from the DSS must be given the presumption of certainty, a presumption of correctness, until it is rebutted. It's a rebuttable presumption. But in law, any document emanating from the government, there's a presumption that it is regular, it is true, until rebutted. So are they withdrawing, going to ask DSS to withdraw that report? So what is the purpose of the investigation? There is no purpose.